A very good afternoon to all the participants of the 53rd annual conference of the Society of Nuclear Medicine. Thanks to the organizers for inviting me to give a talk on cyclotron-produced PET radiopharmaceuticals, need and supply. When this invitation came to talk on the need and supply of PET radiopharmaceutical, I had a dilemma. Should I address this problem as a senior radiopharmaceutical scientist administrator with over 45 years of experience, or should I confine myself as a radiochemist associated with a private group operating a cyclotron and couple of nuclear medicine departments? I decided that I will spend my time between the two. I will initially talk about the need and availability with respect to the PET CT radiopharmaceuticals in India. Then I will go to the specifics on some of the radiopharmaceuticals. Why do we need PET radiopharmaceuticals? 95% of our need for PET radiopharmaceuticals is in oncology. We need the radiopharmaceuticals for staging, monitoring therapy response, restaging, and recurrence evaluation. Of course, there is other use like in neurology, cardiology, and infection, but these are currently very limited, not many. Which is the most common PET radiopharmaceutical? What is needed? Of course, it is FDG or fluorodeoxyglucose. FDG is used for imaging all proliferative or fast-growing cancers. FDG is not good for cancers that are slow-growing. Prostate cancer, neuroendocrine tumors, and other indications, FDG will not be very good. We need other F-18 radiopharmaceuticals other than FDG. We also need gallium-68 radiopharmaceuticals. But if you look at a PET center, more than 90% of the PET CT imaging done, not only in India, the world over is with this single radiopharmaceutical called FDG. FDG was called the molecule of the millennium by Dr. H.N. Wagner, who is considered as the father of nuclear medicine. 95% of the revenue of a cyclotron center is from FDG. 95% of the revenue of a PET center comes from FDG PET. Hence, FDG is the most important need, and let us look at the availability of FDG in India. It is also important to review how is the situation in the world. Now, there are 2,500 PET scanners in hospitals across the US that collectively perform something like about 2 million scans per year. So considering our population, which is about four times higher, so we need anywhere around 8 million scans per year. Maybe we can be conservatively, at least we should have the facility to do the scan for about 2 million scans. Now in US, they have about 249 cyclotrons in USA. They have 590 PET scanners in Japan in 2017, which is an average of 4.6 PET scanner per million population. Now this number would have further increased in Japan. In Japan, they have 218 cyclotrons. In China, they have 175 cyclotrons. Now, IEA suggests that there should be at least one PET CT scan for a million population. So what's our need? We need at least 1,350 PET CT scanners for that many million population in India, because our population is 135 crores or 1,350 million. Assuming that a cyclotron can cater to about 20 machines, we need minimum 70 cyclotrons in India in the next 5 years. What is our current status? It is not very optimistic. If you look at the map of India, we have a couple of cyclotrons in Chandigarh. There is a cluster of 6 cyclotrons in Delhi. There is one in Lucknow, 2 in West Bengal, 1 in Assam. There are a couple in Hyderabad, Mumbai, they have 3, Bangalore, they have 4, Chennai, 1, Kochi, 1. Now, if you look at the map of India and look at it, there are large gaps actually. There are no cyclotrons anywhere near here, and it is very difficult to operate PET CT machines in these places. Okay, there are some places where radiopharmaceuticals are flown from different places and used, but that is not very efficient. Looking at the distribution of cyclotrons in the USA, probably there is a cyclotron in the East Coast. Every 100 kilometer you have a cyclotron. Maybe in the West Coast it is little less distributed. But the FDG or the F-18 radiopharmaceuticals are available within maybe a couple of hours by drive everywhere. Is FDG available to all patients in India? Certainly not. 23 cyclotrons are spread in 11 states. Half the machines are in government sector and hence catered to only single user. We need another 50 cyclotrons to be set up in our country in the next 5 years. There should be a situation where a patient needs to go for a scan as an outpatient, maybe about 2 hours travel. One should be able to get to a nuclear medicine center where they can do a PET CT. Otherwise, the cost of PET CT will be much higher because you need to arrange for the travel, you need to arrange for the overnight stay, you need to arrange for the onlook of your partner who is coming along with the patient. So the travel time should be at least less than about a couple of hours, which I will put it as ideal. And I would like to mention what is our Kerala model. We have the molecular cyclotron project in Cochin. This was made by private investors. This is part of a new cancer hospital which is under construction. This is almost nearing completion. And our focus on targeted therapy will be, in this cancer hospital other than other modality of treatments. We also plan to distribute PET radiopharmaceuticals to other nuclear medicine departments. So this is our cyclotron. We have 11 MeV Siemens machine. It has got dual beam capability with the 60 microamp beach. We have a class C clean rooms. We have a class B hot cells for production. We have four modules. Then we have a class A hot cell for dispensing, and we have an extensive quality control laboratory. Now using this cyclotron, we are placed in Cochin. We service to about 15 to 17 nuclear medicine departments on a daily basis. These departments are spread in, they are in Calicut, they are in Trichur. There are 5 departments in nuclear medicine departments in Ernakulam, then 3 in Trivandrum, and we also give it to Coimbatore as well as to the nearby Kanyakumari district. Now, looking at this map, our patients, they need to travel maybe less than about 2 hours to get a PET CT scan. This is thanks to the cyclotron what is put by the molecular cyclotron group in Cochin. Now, how should a new cyclotron project be planned? Obviously, I will feel that what is important is to have the more yield of F-18 as well as F-18 radiopharmaceuticals. Higher energy machine is needed, maybe 16.5 to 20 MeV machine is the best. Higher beam current up to 300 microamp machines are available. Go for the highest beam current. We should plan for multiple hot cells for rest of the radiopharmaceuticals. It is good to have liquid target for gallium-68 if there are about 4 or 5 nuclear medicine centers in the vicinity where we can drive and take the radiopharmaceutical in less than 1 hour. The solid targets, it's a big question. I am not in favor of having a solid target in private cyclotrons. Definitely, it is better to dabble in radiochemistry in government sector to keep the academic activity going on. So the government sectors can have solid targets, and it may not be very economical for private centers to have solid targets. And it is more important to look for the transportation logistics. The cyclotron should be able to take the radiopharmaceuticals from the production center to nearby hospitals in the minimum time. And we do all our operations in the night. Now, I will now shift to a radiochemist perspective on PET radiopharmaceuticals, the need and availability. What are the PET radionuclides used in nuclear medicine? We know about fluorine-18 and gallium-68. And if you look at it, there are a large number of other PET radionuclides, C11, nitrogen 13, oxygen 15, the copper 61, copper 64, yttrium 86, zirconium 89, and this list can go further. But I will certainly feel that the nuclear medicine doctors are happy if they have an abundant supply of F-18 as well as gallium 68. Let us look at those radiopharmaceuticals that will do good for the patients, but not widely used. Now, coming to F-18 radiopharmaceuticals beyond FDG, if you look at the literature, the synthesis of a few hundreds of F-18 radiopharmaceuticals are reported in the literature. Now, many of them can be prepared in cyclotron centers using cassette-based chemistry. For example, in our cyclotron, we can make F-DOPA, choline, PSMA, MESO, FET, FES, sodium fluoride. These products can be made by using our cassette-based chemistry. And I will go into one production of one typical radiopharmaceutical. Are these radiopharmaceuticals easy to make? The production is based on cassette-based chemistry. Synthesis involves multiple steps. Multiple purification steps are included in the production route. The production yields are low. Need to do careful QC before release of the product, and the batch can fail. Coming to F-DOPA, F-DOPA is a key tracer used for multiple indications. For example, it is used for Parkinson's disease by neurologists, neuroendocrine tumors by oncologists. Earlier, F-DOPA used to be prepared by electrophilic synthetic route. And at the time, the cyclotron should have a deuteron beam. The RMC cyclotron, we wanted a deuteron beam because we wanted to make F-DOPA. We need to have a neon gas target if you want to make F-DOPA. The specific activity of the product formed is less because in the neon, we dope some amount of fluorine so that the F-18, what is coming out of the neon target, is not carrier free. It will be carrier added. But F-DOPA synthesis through nucleophilic route is a seminal achievement of radiochemists. Because you know this is a wonderful chemistry developed by the good radiochemist so that we can use the water project, what is available in our cyclotron, and make F-DOPA. But the synthesis route is difficult. Now, this is F-DOPA. F-DOPA is a small molecule. It has a benzene ring with the two hydroxyl groups, and we have the F-18 in the ortho position. There is an amino acid, there is an amine group and COH group. In order to make these small molecules, we have to start with a complex chemistry. So we start with a nitro precursor, fairly large molecule. This is the nitro group, which we exchange it with the fluorine. And this OH group, NH2 and the COOH, they are all protected. We put a MOMO group to protect the OH here. We converted this to an aldehyde group. A trityl group is used to protect the amine. A tertiary butyl group is used to protect the acid group. Now, this precursor is reacted with the fluoride, which is coming from the reactor, which is absorbed by the TBA in bicarbonate buffer. The fluoride gets exchanged with nitro, and this is what the labeled precursor. This labeled precursor, we do an oxidative chemistry using metachloroperoxybenzoic acid to convert this CHO group into a ketonic group. And after conversion, we do an acid hydrolysis. And after the acid hydrolysis, you do get the product F-DOPA. This is F-DOPA, what is used. But now looking at the cassette-based chemistry, it involves several steps. First of all, it is a trapping of F-18 in the QMA cartridge, elution with TBA bicarbonate, azeotropic drying with acetonitrile, addition of the precursor and radio labeling, then a purification of the labeled precursor in a solid phase cartridge, then elution of the purified labeled tracer into the reaction tube. Then we do the oxidation step. After the oxidation, we do the hydrolysis with concentrated Cl. Then you get a crude product which is further purified in solid phase cartridges. This is finally eluted with buffer through light alumina and wax cartridges, and the final product is filtered through 0.22 micron filter and sent for the patient. Looking at this is an awfully difficult chemistry. And probably if you start with something like about 5 curie of activity, we will end up with about 200, 250 millicurie of activity only. So this, some of these F18 ready pharmaceutical synthesis are difficult. The batches can fail and the yields will be low. So the doctors should be willing to pay for these radiopharmaceuticals. These cannot be expected with the same price like FDG. Now, once we have the radiopharmaceutical, the doctors are happy. This is the PET MRI scan with F-DOPA taken by Dr. Shanmugasundaram in Amrita Hospital in Cochin. This is probably a normal patient, and you can see the uptake of the radio tracer very, very nicely. So like F-DOPA, there are at least half a dozen other F-18 radiopharmaceuticals which can be routinely used and prepared from a cyclotron center. Now I will shift to the second important radionuclide, that is gallium-68. And gallium-68 radiopharmaceuticals are also in wide need now. Now, germanium-68 radiopharmaceuticals, gallium-68 radiopharmaceuticals, the first thing is what we need is a germanium generator is needed. It's a long-lived parent radionuclide. We can use the generator almost for about 9 months. The gallium eluted is 68 minutes only. That means we can elute the generator multiple times in the same day, and it's a beautiful radionuclide. You know, the high positron yield, almost 87% positron yield is very good. This gives excellent radionuclide for PET imaging. And we develop the radiopharmaceuticals using a bifunctional chelating agent principle. It is not the direct labeling like what we do in F-18. What is a bifunctional chelating agent principle? See, we want to target a molecule. Assume that this is somatostatin receptor. And the biomolecule is probably, you think that it is actually the somatostatin analog, the peptide. This somatostatin analog peptide or any biomolecule can be linked to a bifunctional chelating agent. So this bifunctional chelating agent, the role is actually it will chelate the gallium radionuclide and will hold it very, very strongly inside it. And at times, you can either directly put the bifunctional chelating agent to the molecule, or there will be a need for a linker. That means you put a spacer molecule so that the biomolecule and the chelating agents, they are actually farther off. Now, this is the gallium PSMA, one of the very beautiful radio pharmaceuticals what every one of us has there. We want to image the prostate-specific membrane antigen, which is overexpressed in prostate cancer as well as different type of other cancers. So we have the pharmacophore, which is a lysine glutamic acid. Then this is our chelating agent, and you put a 9-carbon linker, you know, very nicely illustrating the principle of the bifunctional chelating agent. Now, there are a large number of gallium radiopharmaceuticals available. You have the Dotatate and Dotanoc for neuroendocrine tumors, gallium PSMA for prostate and several other cancers. We have the new molecule, the fibrinoblast activation peptide inhibitor. Many types of cancers can be imaged using this. Pentaxy-4 can be used for multiple myeloma. Exendin-4 can be used for insulinomas. And we can also use gallium-68 bisphosphonates for bone metastasis. It will work like F-18 sodium fluoride, and it will be much better than technetium HMDP. Now, this list will keep on increasing as there are chemists working towards development of new radiopharmaceuticals. Now, how do we develop new radiopharmaceuticals? Earlier, we were thinking that, okay, we can use antibody as a targeting molecule, but unfortunately, the molecular weight of antibody is very high. It moves very slowly in the bloodstream. So we came with the peptides. Peptides are small molecules, maybe having molecular weight of about 1,200. Somatostatin analogs have given beautiful radiopharmaceuticals. And now we use inhibitors like PSMA, we use PAPI. And of course, our human body is, the whole metabolism of the human body depends upon the enzymes, and many more inhibitor-based radiopharmaceuticals will come in future. So the future is very, very good as far as development of new gallium 68 radiopharmaceuticals are concerned. Now, if you want to do these gallium radiopharmaceuticals, we need such a gallium, germanium gallium generator. You know, there are about 300 PET CT centers in India right now. At least one generator is needed, and the cost of a 30 millicurie generator is anywhere between 15 to 17 lakhs. That means this is something like about a 50 crore business is there, and this can go up as the number of cyclotron increases, number of PET CT centers increase. So one of the fundamental question is, can we make the generator in India? Why not? The main issue is the availability of germanium 68. Now, if you want to make germanium 68, we can take a gallium 69. We do an irradiation with a proton. Two neutrons will come out, and germanium 68 will be produced. And for this, we need actually cyclotron, which is having an energy up to about 30 MeV. That means this is the cross section. As at a lower energy, the amount of activity formed will be less. As energy increases to 20, the cross section comes to almost like about 550 millibonds, which is considered to be very good. So we can make this provided we have a 30 MeV cyclotron available in the country. Now, coming to that, we have a 30 MeV cyclotron machine available at Calcutta. This is part of the Department of Atomic Energy. This machine was originally planned for the preparation of gallium 67, indium 111, iodine 123, and thallium 201. Now, if you look at the, if you ask the nuclear medicine physicians and ask them, would you need these radiopharmaceuticals? They will probably say that, no, we are happy without this. Maybe, you know, thallium 201, people say it's a gold standard for myocardial perfusion imaging. But the nuclear medicine physicians are now well versed with using other technetium-based myocardial perfusion imaging agents. Now, this 30 MeV cyclotron, if it can be dedicated for the production of germanium 68, it will be doing a great service to the country. Because we can make adequate amount of germanium 68 by using this cyclotron and irradiating it for a longer time, developing a gallium, natural gallium target, solid target. Because of course, the gallium has a problem that, you know, it is a low melting point element. So some alloy has to be made. And if that is done and germanium 68 is produced, parallelly, we need to develop the generator adsorbents and the preparation of the germanium 68 radiopharmaceuticals. So this will be one of the very good program what this 30 MeV cyclotron can be dedicated to by the Department of Atomic Energy, Department of Atomic Energy, which will do a great deal of good to the nuclear medicine community. Now, coming to probably coming out of the PET radiopharmaceutical need and supply, I will also like to put a caution on the need and supply of all radiopharmaceuticals. Now, as you know, the Dhruva reactor is the one what is making radiopharmaceuticals, the radioisotopes in India. We get the iodine from there, we get lutetium from there, and we also get several other isotopes from there. And this reactor is nearly 40 years old, and the reactor has got a definite life. Maybe, I don't know how many more years they plan to run this reactor, but once this reactor stops functioning or it is decommissioned, the cost of radioisotopes can skyrocket in India. You know, you think about what is the cost of radiopharmaceuticals or radioisotopes in countries where they don't have a reactor that is much, much higher than what we have in India. So it is important that a new reactor is the need for nuclear medicine to sustain in this country. And I hope that this message gets to the Department of Atomic Energy, and whatever efforts they are taking to put the new reactor will be accelerated much faster. So with this, I will close my talk. I thank all the audience for the patient listening. And I maintain an academia website. This website is openly available, and all my talks and papers and books, everything I load in this academia website, and all the nuclear medicine colleagues and all the younger residents, as well as the nuclear medicine technology students, they can look into this academia website and get all the information. Thank you very much. Thanks once again to the organizers for inviting me to give this talk. Thank you. Thank you very much.